that says, when I see the blood, I will pass over. When I see the blood, I will pass over. And there's a reason why we sing that song. It's not just a song that somebody made up because it sounded good, but it's a song that actually expresses how God works. And we all know that he went to the cross for our good, our salvation, for our healing, and for our deliverance. And we just thank you, God. Thank the Lord for this. Get us ready to look at everybody. Have a night to read. All right. When the children of Israel were in bondage, God called a man called Moses to bring them out of bondage. And we all know the story of how Moses felt like he was not the one. And most of the time, actually, we feel, I'm not the one. You know, Lord, tell us something. No, not me. It's not me that you want. Somebody else. Because and we have all of us have our excuses for why we think we're not the one that God wants to use in that particular way. However, the Lord gave Moses some instructions, and he told him in the 7th chapter, I don't have that down yet, but in the 7th chapter, he says, I have made you like God the Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron will be your prophet. And so you are to say everything I command you, and your brother Aaron is to tell Pharaoh to let the Israelites go out of his country. So, but he told him in the beginning, I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. And though he says, I'll multiply my signs and wonders in Egypt, he's not going to listen to you, meaning Pharaoh. So then I'm going to lay my hand on Egypt with mighty acts of judgment. I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt, excuse me, and bring the Israelites out of it. Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old and Aaron 83 when they spoke to Pharaoh. Now that sounds like that's pretty old to get started, but that's what he started. So he told them, said, now, when Aaron says, perform whatever, take your staff and says it's going to be a snake, and then he commanded him to throw the snake down. He gave him a sign to know that he was with him. But here's what we want you to read. The first
scripture.
Exodus 8:23.
Mm-hmm. I will make a difference between my people and your people. Tomorrow this sign shall be.
Yes, Lord.
And the Lord did so. Thick swarms of flies came into the house of Pharaoh, into his servants' houses, and into the land of Egypt. The land was corrupt because of the swarms of flies. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron and said, go sacrifice to your God in the land. And Moses said, it is not right to do so, for we would be sacrificing the abomination of the Egyptian to the Lord our God. If we sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptian before their eyes, then will they not stone us? We will go 3 days' journey into the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God as he will command us.
All right. Now, here's what I want you to see. He said, I'm going to make a distinction between my people and your people. And what I'm I'm saying there's nothing but the blood, because the blood is what made the distinction between Pharaoh letting them go and the children of Israel being free. And the blood is what makes the distinction between us and the world. Because we believe that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and shed his blood. So he said in Isaiah, by his stripes we are healed. So we believe that. And our belief makes us distinct from the world. Because the world, they don't believe that. You know, some of them try to when they get desperate, but they really don't believe that the blood makes the difference. And we want to show you how God, you see, between a saint and a sinner, there ought to be a difference.
Yeah.
And I've been saying to myself and to the Father, I'm so tired of seeing so many saints sick. Now, I know that when you get sick, God heals.
Yeah.
But, and so you can't know the healing power of God unless you do get sick.
Yeah.
So it's not the matter of being sick, but it's the matter of not seeing, in, not, I can't say that about our particular group because God's been healing everybody.
Yeah.
But I'm saying that in some instances, it seems as though the Christians stay sick just as long as a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
But we ought to be manifesting the power of God by getting deliverance.
Yeah.
And I've heard many testimonies in our church of people that have been delivered.
Yeah.
Right.
And there ought to be a difference between our poverty level and the poverty level of the world.
Yeah.
In other words, if there's 7% unemployed in the world, it ought to be 2 or 3% in church. It ought not be 7% of us. You understand? There should be a difference between us and them.
Yeah.
Because God said he was going to make a difference.
Amen.
That's what he said.
Amen.
So we've got to learn how to believe God and get our prayers answered. And you know, it's not a matter of getting our prayers answered, it's believing that they are answered.
Yes.
And sometimes we think, well, they're not answered because this, that, or the other.
Mm-hmm.
But they're always answered. It's just that we're like in the hall waiting for the answer to come to us. Because God has said it. If you pray the prayer, God has already dispatched his angels with the word and the answer. So it is coming.
Yes.
It is coming.
Amen.
And we've got to believe it with all of our heart that there is a distinction between the world. I don't believe the world ought to be better off in any way. Now, I'm not talking about better off when they're talking about being a millionaire and having a whole lot of money and all that. But I'm talking about as God opening doors and making ways for his people, I believe there should be a distinction between what happens to us when we get in trouble and what happens to the world when they get in trouble. Because when we get in trouble, we can go to God and say, Lord, I'm your child.
Yes.
And I solicit your help. I want your help. I need your help. And I'm trusting you.
Yes.
But the world can't say I'm your child because they're not. So then all they do is go to the doctor or go to the lawyer or go to whoever they think will give a favor. But we can go to God and say, I need favor.
Yes.
Whether it's with a doctor or a lawyer or whoever it's with, you know, a neighbor, whoever it is, with relationships, we can say, Lord, I need favor.
Yes.
And God will give us favor. Sometimes he'll give us something to do like he did to Moses. And so we've got to learn to do what he tells us to do, even though it may seem insignificant.
Yes.
We've got to do it in order to get what God has for us. Mm-hmm. All right, the next scripture.
Exodus 9:4. And the Lord will make a difference between the livestock of Israel.
Now here you go again.
and the livestock of Egypt. So nothing shall die of all that belongs to the children of Israel.
Now, do you see what he says? The Lord will make a distinction here between the livestock of Israel and that of Egypt, so that no animal that belongs to the Israelites shall die. Oh, Lord. He said, Pharaoh, I'm going to show you who's God here.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a distinction between
yes.
them and us.
Okay.
It's a them and us. It's a them and us. He's going to make a distinction between his children and the other fellow's children. Oh, bless his name. A distinction. All right. The next scripture.
So the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, take for yourselves handfuls of ashes from the furnace, and let Moses scatter it toward the heavens in the sight of the Pharaoh.
A little more.
And it will become fine dust in all the land of Egypt, and it will cause boils that break out in sores on land and beasts throughout all the land of Egypt. Then they took ashes from the furnace and stood before Pharaoh, and Moses scattered them toward heaven, and they caused boils that break out in sores on land and beasts.
This is the plague of the boils. Now, God said, look, he didn't listen to us this first time. So we're going to take, I want you to take, told Moses there, take a handful of soot or ashes from the furnace and toss them into the air. And it's going, we're in the, where are you reading? The 9 and 8. Exodus 9 and 8. And 9, you read. And it's going to be dust over all the land of Egypt. And festering boils are going to break out of men and animals throughout all the land. So they did exactly what God said do, and the boil broke out on men and the animals. And the magician, they couldn't stand before Moses because there were so many boils on them. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. He still didn't let the children go. We're talking about nothing but the blood of Jesus. In other words, the blood is what separates us from them. We believe the blood covers us.
Amen.
They don't know anything about that. As a matter of fact, they think that's silliness. As a matter of fact, I remember a preacher that came here, a teacher. He was a good teacher, except he didn't have a good handle on the blood. And he said, we were praying, we prayed a prayer like, we plead the blood of Jesus. He said he never saw that in the Bible before. Well, you know, you don't have to see that in the Bible to say it, because that's what we do when we say we plead the blood. In other words, we know the dividing line between them and us.
Yes.
That means the children of the devil and the children of God.
Yes.
We're the children of God, and it's the blood that we depend on for the sanctification of our soul, the saving of our soul, the healing of our bodies.
Yes.
The deliverance of whatever it is that we need to be delivered from, we believe that Christ's blood atoned for all of that.
Yeah.
We believe that's it.
Yes.
The blood, and we also believe that the blood has never lost its power.
Amen.
We believe that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Hallelujah.
Whatever and whoever he was back in Moses' time, we believe that same God is working today to deliver us whatever we need deliverance for. Whatever it is that we need deliverance for, that same God is working. All we have to do is listen for what. See, in every one of these cases, God told them to do something. And it didn't have anything to do with their lifestyle. You know what I'm saying? In other words, sometimes we say, well, the Lord might do this for me if maybe I had fasted for 5 days, or maybe if I'd have prayed all night, maybe if I'd have done this. He gave them some very natural things to do. See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Things that they could do. And Moses did every one of them.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that you shouldn't fast or nothing like that. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying sometimes we doubt God because of something we think we didn't do or something we think we did. No. All you to do is what he told you to do.
Yes.
He told Moses and Aaron, get the hands full of this dirt or soot and throw it up in the air, and it's going to become dust over the whole land. It's going to break boils out of people. So, I mean, just get the handful of dust and throw it up there. I mean, at least you figure, find out if it's going to work. You know, if something's not working, at least you can do what he said do.
Amen.
To see if it'll work.
Amen.
And of course, in this case, Moses just kept on following God. And even though he did what God told him to do, Pharaoh didn't let him go.
And he even said that was going to happen.
But Moses was still trusting in God.
Yeah.
Because you see, we're going to get to the point because it's always the blood that covers.
Yes.
All right, let's read the next scripture. Exodus 9:19.
Therefore, sit now and gather your livestock and all that you have in the field. For the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and is not brought home, and they shall die.
Keep on reading.
He who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand towards heaven, that there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, on man, on beast, and on every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched out his rod towards heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire darted to the ground, and the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt, so there was hail and fire mingled with the hail, so very heavy ground was done like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt and all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree in the field. Only the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail.
Did you hear that? Only in the land of Goshen,
hallelujah,
where the children of Israel were, there was no hail.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the difference that God will make for his children.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Like,
no,
and those that don't belong to him. He knows how to protect his folks. That might have been the next, I think I was going to read down to the next one. So did you get the next 10 and 13? Hail struck through all the land of Egypt, but there was no hail where the Israelites were. Don't you think God can notice that? God knows how, he says, to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust until the day of reckoning to be
fed.
He knows how to do it. Only God knows how.
Hallelujah.
We don't know how to do it, but God knows how to do it.
Yes, he does.
And he will do it. He just wants you to be ready for it.
Yes.
You just be ready by doing whatever it is he asks you to do.
Hallelujah.
Which is always something easy.
Yes. Amen.
All he did in this case was he told the Israelites to make sure that all of your flock were inside. Isn't that what he said?
That's what he said.
Just everybody, you just put all yours inside. Because everything that's on the outside is going to go down. You put yours on the inside. So, I mean, simple stuff.
Yes.
Nothing hard to do, just simple stuff. But God knows what to do to get you ready for what he's going to do, which is bring you deliverance.
Thank you, Jesus.
He wants to get you ready for it.
Thank you so much, Jesus.
The next scripture.
Exodus 10, 13.
That's right.
So Moses stretched out his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought an east wind on the land all that day and all that night. When it was morning, the east wind brought the locusts.
Hallelujah.
Keep reading.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the locusts went up over the land of Egypt and rested on all the territory of Egypt. They were very severe. Previously, there had been no such locusts as they, nor shall there be such after them. For they covered the face of the whole earth, so that the land was dark, and they ate every herb of the land and all the fruit of the trees, which the hail had left. So there remained nothing green on the trees or on the plants of the fields throughout all the land of Egypt.
There you go. Now, again, he stripped all the trees in the land of Egypt. But in the land of Goshen, everything was still green. You tell me God don't know how.
Yes, you don't
know. He knows what to do. He said, I'm going to show it. And Pharaoh's heart was hardened.
Yes.
Because the scripture says he hardened his heart, because what God wanted to do is to show his power.
Yes.
See, God wants to show his mighty power, his miracle working power. And he does it, but I'm saying but because it's the only thing he's asked us to do is be obedient to what he says to do.
Amen.
That's all he said to do. Just be obedient. Oh, Jesus.
My God.
And in this case, he told Moses to stretch out his staff over Egypt, and the Lord made these winds blow. And that's where our locusts came in. Just stretch out your staff. Now, isn't that easy to do? Just you got a hand, you got a staff in your hand, just stretch it out. He could have said, I don't feel worthy, or I don't feel like it. He could have said any of those things. Well, I'm tired of it. I tried that before. You know, he just obeyed. He just obeyed. And when he obeyed, victory is on his way. But it hadn't come. Isn't that something? It hadn't come because Pharaoh still said, shut up. I'm not letting him go. Well, he did say, I'm going to let him go. But he didn't. Because, all right, let's go to the next one, which is Exodus 10 and 21, right after where he was. 10:21.
Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, darkness which may even be felt. So Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone raise from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwelling.
No, they didn't. Right. No, they didn't.
3 days, too.
Isn't that when I was studying this, I said, you know, because I have a whole lot of other stuff about the blood. I said, no, this is it. The Lord wants us to know that he is supreme. He does what he will and how he wants to do it. And all we have to do is follow.
They said, Lord.
Darkness. So much darkness that the folks were scared to move anywhere. But all Israel had light in the place where they lived. Oh, Lord. So Pharaoh, he got kind of scared then. He said, well, go on and worship the Lord. But he said, only your women and children can go with you. He said, leave your flocks and your herds behind. Moses said, oh no, No, it's not gonna. We're not gonna have. We're gonna do the whole thing, the whole show. To me, this is an awesome story. It's awesome.
Thank you, Lord.
It ought to really give us a lot of faith, knowing that we belong to God and God's gonna bring deliverance to us. All we have to do is just be obedient to Him. That's all. That's all He asks us. Just do what He said. So Moses said, you gotta allow us to, we gotta have our animals because we need to make some sacrifices. And we can't do that. So the Lord said, okay. And Pharaoh said, he actually told him, when you get out of my sight, don't come back again. And you come back again, you're gonna die. And Moses says, okay, I'll never appear to you again. Get out of your face, and we'll see what happens. So then, now the Lord said, I'm gonna get the big guns out now. Read the next scripture, Exodus 11. I didn't say what verse, so just start with one.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord said to Moses, I will bring the war plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt, afterwards he will let you go from here. When he lets you go, he will surely drive you out of here together, all together. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor, and every woman from her neighbor, articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, moreover than Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servant, and in the sight of the people.
Keep reading. You read the whole chapter here.
Then Moses does say, the Lord, about midnight, I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh, who sits on the throne, even to the firstborn of the female servant who is behind the handbill, and all firstborn of the animals. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall be like it again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move his tongue, against man or beast, that you may know that the Lord does make a difference between the Egyptians and Israel.
Now, do you hear what he said? I said, I'm going to go through here. I'm going to kill all the firstborn of the Egyptians, all the firstborn of the even of the animals. Said, but you won't even, a dog will even be hurt in the Israeli camp.
Hallelujah.
Not even your dog. Not the dog will bark. I won't even frighten them, so they'll be barking. They won't even know what's going on.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, we serve a God in our hand.
Amen.
I mean, I'm saying a God in a hand. I don't know how to express it. But a mighty God. A mighty God. But among the Israelites now, a dog will bark.
Hallelujah.
Our animal. And then you'll know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel.
Hallelujah.
So Moses so he left Pharaoh, and he said Pharaoh refused to listen so that all these wonders would be multiplied. And they all these things he had done before Pharaoh, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, he wouldn't let the Israelites go out of the country. So here we're going to chapter 12, and we'll see what's going on here.
Exodus 12 and 7, mm-hmm. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts on.
Now, where are they going to get this blood from?
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now, You shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boil at all with water, but roast it in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall eat none of it, you shall let none of it remain until morning. And what remains of it until morning, you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist and sandals on your feet and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover.
All right, 12.
For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord.
13.
Okay. Now the blood shall be a sign for you in the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt.
Now, did you hear that?
Yeah.
The plague shall not be on you when I strike the land of Egypt.
I sure will.
Talk about recession. We're not participating.
That's right.
Amen.
We're not participating. Whatever's going on in the world, we don't participate in it.
That's right.
Don't even let it come out of your lips about what, how hard things are, because things are going to be better for you as long as you're doing what God told you to do.
Yes.
Now, if you're not doing what God told you to do, that's something different.
Yeah.
But if you live it for God, I don't mean that you never did any, made any mistakes. That's not what I'm talking about. But if you know what God told you to do and you're not doing it, then you can't expect God to work in your behalf. But if you just do what he told you to do, God's going to work.
Yes, he will.
I mean, there is absolutely no doubt about it. He said, now, I want you to put this blood on your doorpost, and when I see the blood, I'll pass over. And no destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. Reminds me of a scripture in the Psalm. It said, 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shall thou see the reward of the night. I was thinking of all the people that have been afflicted with the flu. I have not heard another saint die with it. God brought everybody out.
Amen.
Not that they could not have, but if you trusted in the Lord, he going to bring you all out. We got to believe, folks.
Yes.
We got to believe. Mm-hmm. So we commemorate the fact that, let's go to the next scripture, 14 and 16.
14 and 16, mm-hmm. Says, but lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea.
Now, after Pharaoh let them go, he had second thoughts about it. And so they were going to the river over the sea. And so they said, let's go catch them. But God had opened up the sea, a way through the sea for the children of Israel to pass by, pass through. And so when Pharaoh's host decided they were going to go in, then the waters came back together, and they were all dry. And that's where we get and from him Pharaoh's army got founded. Mary, don't you weep. Mary, don't you weep. Pharaoh's army got founded. Oh, Mary, don't you weep. Don't you moan. Woo!
And God said, Moses, and the Pharaoh will let you go this time. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, it's not that he just won't let you go, but he gonna like drive.
And he didn't say no
about it. Yeah,
he was sick of the people. They were making his land nothing.
Desolate
is the word. That's a good one. Make it a desolate. Oh my God, my God. So he said, what I want them to know. He said, well, actually, he said in that 14, so I'm going to harden the hearts of the Egyptians. So they will go in after them. That's what they did. And I'm going to gain glory through Pharaoh and all his army, through the chariots and horsemen. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh, his chariot, and horsemen. They will know. Now, of course, they knew by the fact that they drowned. But the ones that weren't going after it, there was somebody left to tell the story. See, somebody's going to be watching you to see how you come out in your trial and your test.
Yeah.
And if you just do what God said, he's going to bring you out and people are going to know it was the Lord.
Yeah.
It was nothing that you did. It was simply the Lord. All right, we're going to a few more scriptures we have about the blood.
Hebrews 10. By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the blood of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stand ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down at the right hand of God.
Hallelujah.
From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us. For after he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. Then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more.
All right. I just want to add, this is the sacrifice that Jesus made. That all of the things that he said back in the Old Testament, he hadn't come to the cross. He hadn't died. He hadn't done any of that at that time. But he was still God.
Yes.
But when he came in the flesh, we couldn't make sacrifices anymore. The kind, it wasn't acceptable, he said, because animals couldn't take away sin. So they were sacrificing over and over and over animals to atone for their sin. But they had to keep sacrificing because they kept sinning. And so pretty pitiful if we had to bring an animal every time we told a lie, every time we, whatever we did, we would be in a bad shape. This would be a smelly place. So God said, I'm going to put my law in their hearts. I'm not going to make it so that they have to make these kinds of sacrifices. Because by one sacrifice, he purged sin forever. And so we are living in the righteousness of Christ, of the sacrifice that he made. It's not, in other words, it's not about us, but it's about him. And so that's why we don't have to stop and say, well, we'll never answer my prayer because I know I haven't been this, there, or the other for all my saved life. You don't have to stop and do that because what you have is the righteousness of God to lean on. Or the faith of God. Some people say have faith in God, but we need the faith of God. His faith. Because he believed God. So he sent up a prayer for us a long time ago. He said he ever lived to make intercession for us. Now, that's pretty awesome. The Father, Jesus said he lived to make intercession for you. So that means Jesus is ever praying for you. Can you believe that?
Yes.
So you don't have to, all you have to do is send up the word.
Yes.
And the angels take it on up. And he's got it. And they've got it. Because he's the one that is responsible, not us, for our salvation, for our healing, for our deliverance, for our prosperity, for everything that we need. He's the one that's got it. And if he's praying for us, what else do we need? He's praying for us, right? So all we have to do is say what he said. And the angel takes it back up. You know, it's like, I've heard somebody say, it's like God cannot. He cannot. It's impossible for him to cannot do something. He cannot. There is no such thing as he cannot. He said, I can do all things. We can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. And the only way we can do all things is because he has done all things.
Amen.
So we depend on him to bring into fruition what he's already done. In other words, you've got a tree out there. It's got apples on it. The apples are already there. All you have to do is go pick them.
Yeah.
You don't make the apple.
Mm-mm.
How many of you have ever made an apple? How many of you have ever made a banana? Anybody made a banana? How about an orange? How about a grape? It's small.
Yeah, it's small.
Make a grape? No. All you do is go pick what he's already made. All you do is take what he's already provided. If he's provided health, we got to take it. If he's provided strength, we got to take it. If he's provided prosperity, we got to take it. If he provided healing, we got to take it. Because it's already out there. He's already got it. It's on the tree. Just pick it up, because it's yours. And somebody's praying that you'll not realize it's up there. Somebody's hoping that you won't realize it's up there. In other words, the devil's hoping that you don't understand that it's there. He don't want you to take it. He don't want you to get it. So you've got to understand that he cannot do what he cannot do. He cannot be what he cannot be.
That's right.
Because he can be everything and he is already everything. So there's no cannot be cannot.
I understand.
We used to sing a song, he's everything to me. He's my mother and my father, he's my sister and my brother. He's everything to me. Is he?
Yes,
yeah. Amen.
All to be.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right. Put his law in his heart. And then he said, he adds, their sins and lawless acts, I will remember no more. So I'm not gonna remember their sins and acts so much. So why are you worried about the sin you did and you can't pray? And he prayed for you because you're his child.
Amen.
You don't, you get that out of your mind. If you've ever said, Lord, forgive me, because all you have to do is say, you know, with people, sometimes you almost have to say, oh, but Ellen, I'm so sorry. I am so sorry. But look, you don't have to do that with God. Just say, Lord, I'm sorry, forgive me. And it's over. And he said he put it in the sea of forgetfulness. You have to remember it no more.
Thank you, Jesus.
Bringing it up to your
hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Why are you bringing it up to yourself?
Hallelujah.
If he's forgot about it, if the God of heaven has forgot about it, I mean, who do you think you are that you can bear your own sins? And he bore them on the cross. I mean, you think you're that important?
No.
You think you're that powerful? That great? If you can bear your own sins?
Cool.
I don't think so.
Not either.
I don't think so. He said in that 17th verse, and where, with the 18th verse, and where there have been, and where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. If you've been forgiven, why do you think you got to make a sacrifice of God not answering your prayer? God answers prayer.
Amen.
I said he cannot. No. He cannot.
He cannot. Not.
I know that that's not English.
It is.
But I'm just trying to get it across. He cannot. There's no, it's impossible for him to say, I cannot do it. That's the impossible deal. Okay. Because he can do all things. And he has done it. When we sing the song, he's done so much for me, I cannot tell him all. He's done a lot for us. And if he, of all that he's done for us, can we believe that he can do one more thing? Whatever it is, the next thing is you would have done. Let's believe it.
Hallelujah.
All right, let's read the next scripture.
Romans 5 and 9.
All right.
Okay. Much more
glory.
Than.
Glory.
Okay. Much more than having now been justified by his blood.
You've justified by the blood.
You shall be saved from wrath through him.
You're saved from wrath through him. In other words, the wrath of God doesn't rest on his children. Because the blood covers us. Remember, we just read, when I see the blood, he said he will pass over. So we're justified from wrath by the blood. And when he sees the blood, and he's already seen it, because you've already accepted him. If you had not accepted him, he would not see the blood. But he knows when your name got written in the Lamb's Book of Life. He knows that, you know, some of us can't remember the day we got saved, but he does.
Amen.
He's got it written down already in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Praise God.
And, you know, some people say, well, when did you get saved? Well, I don't know, somewhere I gave my heart to the Lord about. But I was, you know, we still like to stamp our land, but we don't even know when we got saved. But whenever you made that, see, salvation is a choice that you make. I know God gives it to us freely, but it's a choice you make. And when you make that choice, it ought to be a day that you remember. I was only 6 years old, so when I made my choice, but I remember it. I can see myself right now. So I was asked to be baptized. And I stood on that pool and clapped my little 6-year-old hands. No more sin for me. I didn't have no idea what sin was. If you're a sinner, you're going to hell. I said, no more sin for me. Yes, I remember that. I remember that day. I mean, I can tell you the date, but I remember the day.
Thank you.
You understand? Oh,
Jesus.
I also remember the day I prayed through until God spoke through me.
Hallelujah.
I remember that day too, but I remember that day that I stood on that pool. I remember that day. Woo, my God.
Hallelujah.
So I know I belong to Him. How about you? All right. You belong to Him. And the scripture says nobody can snatch you out of His hand.
Amen.
Nobody can snatch you out of His hand. Nobody. All right, let's read the next scripture.
Ephesians 1 and 7. In Him we have redemption through His blood.
In Him we have redemption through His blood.
The forgiveness of sin.
The forgiveness of sin.
According to the riches of His grace.
According to the riches of His grace. And His grace is sufficient.
Amen.
The forgiveness of sin. You're already forgiven. You don't need a shrink to tell you. You know, there are people that need to talk to psychiatrists, but you don't need to somebody tell you you forgive them. Because God's already told you that. You just got to believe it. All right, we're almost finished. What's the
Ephesians 2:13. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ.
You brought near. You were afar off, but you were brought near by the blood of Christ. Jesus went to the cross just for you, that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And I would rather have Jesus than anything the someone says this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than anything. We're brought near by the blood of Christ. All right, let's.
Colossians 1:14, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sin.
That's again just scriptures to substantiate the fact that it was His blood, and it is His blood, that cleanses us.
Hallelujah.
That heals us, that keeps us, that preserves us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh my God. Makes us whole. His blood. Another song we sing, I know His blood has made me whole, for I have touched the hem of His garment, and His blood has made me whole. His blood has made us whole. You've touched the hem of His garment when you touch Him.
Thank you, Jesus.
When you ask Him to come into your life, to be your Savior, that touched the heart of God. You know, I have a child, one of my, actually a stepchild, that asked to be adopted by me.
Mm-hmm.
That touched my heart. Mm-hmm. You know, because they have a mother and a father. And of course, but they wanted me to adopt them officially. I did. And so but I'm just saying, to know that somebody wanted me to be their mom.
You're a good mother.
That was, to me, awesome.
She's a good mother.
So I didn't hesitate, well, I guess I didn't hesitate because I wanted to make sure that their mama knew. And, you know, but I adopted. So my point is, it makes the heart of God
thank you,
glad.
Lord. Hallelujah.
You want to be His child.
Yes.
I mean, that to me, that's awesome.
Yes.
Lord, I want to be your child.
Thank you, Lord.
Is that my last scripture? That was the last scripture. Well, we finished right on time. Praise the Lord. Would you please take our, yes. The Lord bless you. Glad for each one of you that were able to come.
Hallelujah.
Everybody's feeling better and better and better.
Amen.
Sometimes this cough doesn't go away so fast, but the main discomfort alleviated makes it good. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
I want to, I know I'm sounding like a mother, but that's what I am.
Amen.
I want you all to wash your hands often. Good. Wash your dishes good.
Amen.
Rinse them good. So that you do not have all the germs built around getting in your body. They say, well, is that something for a preacher to say? Yeah.
Amen.
Sometimes you gotta be reminded. Because sometimes we go in there and we wash our hands like, you know, a half a second. Those hands are not clean. Get back in there and wash your hands often.
Amen.
Wash your hands often. Because the flu doesn't discriminate. You know, germs, and then you stick your hand up in your eye, and that germ goes right on down. You know, it goes through your eye gate.
Yeah.
Amen.
And other gates too, but that's one of them. Wash your hands and wash your dishes. Scald those dishes with hot water. Tired of everybody getting sick. If you can stand, please. I can't. Just rinse your hands, wash them. I want y'all to stay healthy. Father, we give you praise tonight for your marvelous grace and love. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being in your house
today.
We thank you for those who have come.
Hallelujah.
And continue to touch the bodies of those who are sick or afflicted in any manner. Let your healing virtue penetrate. Hallelujah. Everybody. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless those that have special needs. We don't know the needs of your people, but we know, Lord, that you are a supplier of every need.
Yes.
Have our own way now, Lord, and stretch out your hand to bless those who have given. And the offering, bless those who did not have to give. We pray that you would supply every need, not only of this church, but of your children, one by one. Then we ask that you let the words of our mouth, the meditation of our heart,
be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. For you are my strength, and you are my redeemer.
Take it on, start there.